Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Matt Townsend Show. Dr. Matt Townsend here, your guide, your coach. We do what we can on this show to help you get a leg up on this crazy thing we call life. You know, there's so many things to learn, and there's so many things that absolutely make you mad. I'm trying to think of one, because I never get mad. I get even.
Ooh, that
did
sounds,
you hear that?
Yeah, that was really good.
Did I sound like Batman?
No.
Hey, Joe.
What did I sound like? I get even.
Yeah, you sound like the movie announcer guy. Yeah.
I want to be that guy.
He doesn't get mad. He gets even. In a world where he doesn't get mad, he gets even.
That sounds great.
Yeah.
That sounds great with my new headphones.
By the way, that guy's name was Don LaFontaine.
Yeah.
Great guy.
Great money. He made great money.
Voiceover actor. He's no longer with us.
I know.
Yeah. Actually, you know, another voiceover actor, one of my idols, passed away just recently.
Pee Wee Herman.
No.
Okay.
Don Pardo from Saturday Night
Don
Live.
Don Pardo. Yeah.
Yeah. Man was a master at using his voice.
Mm, that's sad.
But, well, he was in his 90s.
I know, but it's still sad.
It is. I saw him at a news conference once. I'm sorry, I'm channeling Don Pardo all of a sudden.
Waxing.
Yeah, but he was talking about his daughter who had just retired. But his daughter told him to keep working, even though he was in his 80s or 90s.
So his daughter retires.
His daughter retires
like
no, age
but Dad,
70.
You've got to keep working.
Yeah, exactly.
Somebody's got to keep the air on. Somebody's got to keep the lights working. Hey, today's going to be a great show. We're talking about anger, and again, you know, everyone gets a little angry. Like, have you ever seen – do you remember when James went off?
Oh, yeah.
Do you remember that?
We had to bring the parole officer in.
Uh-huh, the parole officer and his mother.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And do you remember how his mother just, like, grabbed him at the neck?
Like a cat.
Like a Vulcan – what are the Vulcan grip or whatever?
Yeah, yeah.
And he just went right to his knees.
Mm-hmm.
That was cool.
Yeah, for years my mom has been disciplining me using the Vulcan grip.
Now, where did she learn the Vulcan grip?
Spock.
Yeah, I think it's just watching a lot of Star Trek on television. And
she's got a great grip.
Yeah, yeah, it really is an iron grip. Next time she comes in, Matt, I'll have her do the Vulcan grip to you.
No, hey, I'd be honored.
It'd be great, yeah.
I've never had that. Yeah. Mrs. Birdsall?
You were raised by five women and you never had
Vulcan
that?
Vulcan grip? No.
You're kidding me.
No, they would hold me down. Tell me this wouldn't make you mad. They'd hold me down and they'd sit on me.
Oh, yeah.
And they'd hold my arms. And they'd sit on my gut.
They put drops of water
on
your forehead?
They brush their long 1970s hair over my face.
No.
To this day, I can only date bald women.
Okay.
It's weird.
Does your wife wear wigs then?
Yeah,
is that what
she does.
Okay.
We have to shave her clean, honestly.
You're terrified of hair.
that's what made me angry growing up.
Yeah.
You shouldn't do that. But do you guys get angry very often? Like, are you a road rager?
No, I wouldn't say I am, no.
I can be at times, depending on what happens, yeah.
Really? I don't get angry at other people. I get angry – what do I get angry at?
What I got angry at yesterday was a gentleman who was passing me in the carpool lane on his cell phone.
You know what? I'm sorry.
In the car by himself,
by
the way.
I was in a hurry.
It was just
that made you mad?
You gotta be kidding me.
What? So when you get angry, what do you do? Like, do you yell?
I might scream. If I'm in the car by myself, I'll scream or something, yes. But if I have other people in the car, I try and control myself.
See, would you ever
But it also passes very quick. It's not.
See, that's the thing about anger is it makes you look really stupid.
Yeah. You can do pretty foolish things when you're angry.
Yes.
Yeah. I don't love it, but when someone, like, is mad and they have to go around me. Because I'm in the carpool lane on my cell phone.
That's really funny.
I love to just wave, thanks, because it ticks them off.
Yeah. Well, I find it interesting, though, because it makes me mad that people are still using their cell phones in their cars, even though in Utah we've now passed a law that you're not supposed to handle your cell phone in a car.
Yeah, that makes you mad. You just said that makes you mad.
Mm-hmm.
That's what makes you mad.
It does. That's one thing.
Like, wouldn't you, like if I got knifed.
Oh,
I'd be mad.
Yeah, so would I.
cell phones?
If you got knifed.
I get more mad driving behind somebody that's using their cell phone, that even though there's that law, and then you pass them, then you're looking at them like, seriously? But see, to me, there's been a million reasons to be angry in a car.
Oh, there always is.
I've seen people eating French fries. In fact, I've been one of those people.
So have I.
I've seen people putting on makeup. I'm sure. I've seen I've got a whole seat full of them. But there's a lot. But the reality is it's you're going to freak out and ruin your day and maybe die because somebody's...
That's why I try and let it go as quickly as possible.
That's a great phrase.
Actually, singing that song would probably be very cathartic, too.
Actually, it would.
That song's starting to make me mad.
Oh, really?
I'm sorry.
I didn't feel a catharsis there.
Well, I sing as I pass the people with the cell phone in their hand because I'm telling them, let it go.
Is that what it feels like?
Let it go.
That's like a blocked pore. I just got a blocked pore. Now I'm going to have a zit because I want to blow.
Okay.
Because of that song. See, sorry? James won't even play it anymore.
He won't even play it anymore?
He's scared. No, he keeps reaching for it. But I look at him like, you do, you die.
Well, yeah, whenever I play it, you just like kind of turn beat red.
I used to love it. Like, wow, I don't know what it is.
Calm down.
It's because somebody made fun of it.
Who?
I don't know. I can't remember. It was on the radio today.
Who made fun of it on the radio?
They were talking about, in fact, one of our headlines today. So why don't
we do this?
Why don't we open up our headlines and talk a little bit about anger in our headlines?
Headliners from The Matt Townsend Show, a summary of stories that you might have missed.
Well, looking at some headlines that people make people mad today. Excuse me.
Somebody's got a cold.
No, just some tickle in my throat. What made me mad as I looked through the headlines today, the James Foley execution.
Yeah.
That makes me very mad.
Yep.
That somebody is actually thinking that for their cause it's okay to go and do something like that.
I mean, like, that right there is the bottom of the barrel.
Oh, definitely.
Like, really? There's very few things. There are some things. Let's not even go there. But that's pretty much bottom of the barrel.
Mm-hmm.
And so now you're seeing the worst side of humanity, and that should make everyone mad.
But yet they think the people who did it think they're at the top of the, you know,
well,
food
they're
chain,
mad
so to
because
speak.
They're being bombed.
Well, yeah, but they think, well, this is justified because of our cause.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Taking a person's life because of your cause is not a just thing.
There's one of the reasons why we're talking about anger today, mm-hmm. because eye for eye, I don't know if you've heard.
I've heard, yeah.
It's a new law. It's a different, we have a new
law. It's a new law?
We have a new law.
I thought that changed.
No, that's it. We've changed the law.
Oh, we changed it back?
No, we have a new law, not an eye for an eye.
Oh, okay.
Now you got to turn that cheek.
Right.
So today on the show, we're gonna hit James in the face.
Ooh, and see if he turns?
We're going to see if he'll turn his cheek.
Okay. That sounds like a great plan. Wow.
I just thought
James
of that.
Is glad there's a desk between you and him right now.
No, but we're going to test James's resolve. See, that's the problem. So when somebody starts threatening you, then anger becomes a fairly natural reaction, right?
Yeah, definitely.
Fight, flight. We're going to get into the fight or flight mode.
Mm-hmm.
But what happens when it's not someone trying to kill you, but instead it's like someone saying, hey, get away from my car. Or it's somebody saying, can I just tell you something rude that you did?
Oh, I would almost
now
like,
I want to react.
Yeah, I want to react. But if I did something that offended somebody, I'd like to know.
Would you?
Yeah.
Okay, Sean.
Uh-huh.
Got something to tell you.
Please let me know.
No, but see,
after the show?
But because you're asking for the feedback. But when people are giving you feedback you didn't want, that makes a lot of people mad.
Oh, yes, yes.
Well, especially when they don't present it in a tactful way.
Oh, yeah.
Like, oh, hey, yeah, you're horrible. It's like, oh, thank you.
Did I mention?
Yeah, I really appreciate that.
Did I mention you need a shower?
You're horrible. Yeah.
Okay.
See, that's the key to anger. And in reality, when does this is every day in our lives. So it's one thing to be angry. I think, honestly, you're supposed to have some response emotionally if someone's threatening you.
Definitely.
That's probably healthy. Then you reach a point where now you're just, it's just, I'm just trying to give you feedback, hon. Or now we're fighting about stupid stuff.
What if somebody was threatening your kids?
Oh, yeah. Or coaching them wrong. Or like yelling at your kids while they're coaching.
Oh, yeah, that. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm. Don't mess with my kids.
It's getting more of the Batman sound there.
I know. Rachel.
See, that's what I do, too. When I get angry, I just channel my inner Batman. which you're doing right now, Matt. And it's really great.
I'm actually channeling my outer Batman.
Oh, really?
That's why I'm wearing this outfit.
I was wondering why he has a cowl.
The black around his eyes, too.
I do. So today's show, all dedicated to anger. It sounds negative, but we're going to fight and combat anger. So think about your life. Where do you need to learn to manage your anger better? Where do you, do you have someone in your life that needs to learn some skills about anger management? Make sure you get them to listen to this show today. If you have any questions, comments about anger management, give us a call, 1-855-CHAT-BYU, 1-855-242-8298, or tweet us at BYU Radio. We'd love to get those comments on the air. We're going to take a break. When we come back, Dr. John Livingstone will be joining us, teaching us anger management skills right here on the Matt Townsend Show on BYU Radio. Welcome back, friends, to the Matt Townsend Show. Hey, today we're talking about anger management. You know, a lot of people would argue it's a natural thing. Some people even argue, you know, I am who I am. That's just what I am. Yeah, you know, I'm just angry. I'm just an angry person. Just get off my back. Get out of my face. But in reality, it's something we have to learn to control, because if we can't manage it, then it's going to manage us. It's going to take us over. And in all honesty, if you're not watching the news lately, anger, you know, on a global level causes wars. Anger and justified anger. I mean, it's one thing, everybody can be justified in their anger. The problem is you keep perpetuating the anger, you're going to keep perpetuating the justified anger. And it's everywhere. If you think about it, we're seeing it. And it doesn't, again, diminish the fact that people can really be hurt, and we can hurt and offend people. And yet, how do we manage our emotions? How do we manage our emotion when someone cuts us off on the freeway? You know, we can chase them down. In fact, there's a sad story of a father and a son, I think a stepson, were riding a motorcycle here in Utah. And he had just picked his son up from karate class. And they were driving home, riding home, and a woman threw her cigarette out of the window, and it flew back and hit this motorcycle, and the boy on the back of the motorcycle hit the guy in the head or in the chest or something. So there's the stimulus right there. A cigarette thrown out of a window, and this guy now has a moment of choice. Now imagine you're riding a motorcycle and somebody throws a cigarette at you. That's deadly. You could die because of that. Somebody could cause an accident. So he's at this choice point, but he reacted. He then chased this woman down, got up to the side of her. She freaked out, scared out of her life, and she kind of swerved over, hit him, crashed, killed the man. The boy went to the hospital. In the press conference at the end, after this, when they released the boy says he didn't have to chase her. He just could have let it go, but he didn't. And I thought, holy cow, in the words of a young boy, that's the point. So if you're out there in listener land, we want to give you some tools today and some insight into anger and emotion. We've asked Dr. John Livingstone to join us. He was originally raised, born in Edmonton, Alberta, Canada. He came to Brigham Young University in 1998. He is an associate professor and is a teacher here on campus, also is a counselor, has a PhD in counseling from Brigham Young University in psychology. And he's teaching some classes here this week during Education Week on managing anger. Thanks for being here, John.
Glad to be here.
You've done a lot of marriage counseling.
Yes.
And you teach marriage classes. Anger. It's a huge part of our marriage problems.
It really can be. And, of course, when it gets out of control, angry, yeah, like you were describing, right, about the motorcycle incident, it can get really bad. But in personal relationships, you know, intimate relationships as well as public,
right,
things, anger is just all around us, publicly, privately. And, of course, we just want to be able to handle things, yeah, as well as we can, and understanding kind of the roots of anger.
That's
really
what I want to know, because it sounds like, I mean, so many people would say, well, it's a natural emotion, but so is fear. And a lot of times those natural emotions aren't always accurate.
Yeah. You know, I like to distinguish between feelings and emotions.
Yeah, now, talk about that.
Usually we don't talk like that, but when there's problems in the area, sometimes it's good to split those psychological hairs a little bit and see what we do. You and I are not necessarily in great control of our feelings.
Right.
In other words, if some big guy kicked open the door and fired a shotgun blast into the ceiling, would we decide to be shocked?
Or no
would
choice
it automatically
there.
Happen? Yeah.
It's going to be a response, right?
Yes. And I'm calling those feelings. Psychologists will sometimes talk about primary and secondary feelings. But in my dealing with people, sometimes it's just easier to make a more simple definition. Yeah. So I'm suggesting that things like shock is a feeling. You can't tell when it's coming next. As a matter of fact, if you did know it was coming next, you wouldn't be shocked.
That's right.
It's intermittent. You know it's probably going to come again. You're probably not done with shock in your life. Another example is embarrassment. My goodness, if you're standing up in front of a group of people, someone's making gestures, and sooner or later you find out, oh, dear, your zipper's open.
Yeah. Well, been there, done that.
Yeah, haven't we all? But the thing is that embarrassment is a feeling. We don't have a lot of control over its onset, and it just sort of shows up from time to time.
There and it's it is. There to protect you. I mean, feelings have a purpose.
Yes.
It's to protect you, really, to make sure you either get to take advantage of something and not miss it or not get killed.
Yeah. And we can learn from our feelings. Or, of course, we can go the other way, and like our motorcycle story. Hurt, another example of a feeling. You know, the more important someone is to you, the more deeply you can be hurt by that individual. Frustration.
Yeah.
Same thing. You know, we don't choose to be frustrated. It just kind of shows up, seems to start near our toes and work its way up. And if we don't take care of feelings, why, then we go to emotion. Let me give you one more example, and that is worry. Imagine that you had a 16-year-old daughter. She's out with Joe, tall, dark, and wonderful.
James.
Yes.
Call him James.
And it's now 1:30 in the morning.
Oh.
Oh, you're worried.
Yeah.
You're worried about car accidents and sex and babies.
Yeah.
And
all this stuff.
Things like that. But if at 2 or 2:30 a.m. she walks in the door, seems to be in one piece, is there a chance that it's not worry that you're going to show her?
Yeah, interesting. There's something else.
What happened there? Well, when it looks like she's more or less okay, all of a sudden there's a morphing from worry to anger. I maintain that we decide on anger. We can turn it on. Hmm. We can turn it off. As a matter of fact, let's suppose we left the studio today. You walk to your car. There's a big gunch in the car door. Oh, my goodness. And some teenage boy is doing donuts in the parking lot. Well, you look at the car door. You look at the teenage boy. You start marching over towards him. And then, excuse me. You know, you turn around, and there's the head of BYU Radio.
Ooh.
Matt, I'm so sorry. Is that your – I just backed into your car. Well, the
emotion
that you had all turned on for
the
boy suddenly gets, oh, well, these things happen.
You know, accidents happen.
Exactly. And so I'm calling anger an emotion, something that you emote, something that comes out of you, as opposed to feelings, which I think are a little more incoming, unpredictable, intermittent, like we said, but I really can't make you angry. You have to decide. I can't make you hate, you have to decide. I cannot even make you jealous. You have to decide, so to speak.
So we really end up perpetuating an emotion more through our thinking, our festering, the process of cognition. What we're doing with our brain is creating the emotion.
It may seem like
it's immediate,
automatically move to anger, but there's really a process there. No doubt when the cigarette went out the window and into the helmet or the shirt or wherever it went, why someone may have been shocked, someone may have been hurt.
Scared. Like that could have killed me. Like I almost lost it.
Yeah. And that shock effect then you might say morphed into anger and action was taken rather rashly, you know, and difficult to tell how quickly, you know, someone will move from a feeling to an emotion. But there's the key to managing anger. If we can somehow interrupt our automatic morphing of a feeling to an emotion, then, we may take that extra moment to think. I suggest that people maybe even shout stop in their heads when they realize, oh, my goodness, I am torqued.
Yeah, you this know? Is getting me.
If they can shout stop in their heads and then review back just a second, am I shocked? Am I
what am I going through? What am I feeling?
Am I hurt? Am I frustrated? Am I worried?
Yeah.
What is it? And then if they can actually deal with the feelings instead of dealing emotionally.
Yeah.
Big difference.
Well, in fact, that makes sense because if you might respond differently to your spouse, let's say, if your children are in the room than if they're out of the room, which means you may have a feeling that's immediate, like, I've been attacked, I need to attack back. But if your children are there, you may control yourself.
Exactly.
So just a different scenario may create for you
more
power.
Interrupting that automatic move from a feeling to an emotion
makes
a big old difference. And, of course, I try to invite people to examine just a second. Why am I angry? What is it I'm feeling here? Am I hurt? Am I embarrassed? And then, of course, if they've taken enough time to interrupt, then I suggest a little psychological tool that may be helpful.
Okay, hold on to the – save that tool.
Will.
Because let's take a break and come back, everybody, and listen. John P. Livingstone is teaching us how to manage our emotions and to differentiate the feeling from an emotion. He's going to give us some tools when we come back for what we could be doing in our head to make sure we're not just going with the flow. We're not just taking the spark and, you know, blowing everything up. Powerful, powerful tools today, folks, to help you manage your emotion. We're going to take a break. This is the Matt Townsend Show. Stick with us right here on BYU Radio. Welcome back, friends, to the Matt Townsend Show. Today we are talking about anger management, the importance of, learning to understand yourself and be able to handle life. And the life is going to trigger stuff. That's how life works. You're going to have stuff happen to you, and when it happens to you, feelings can be created, emotions can be conjured up. A lot of times we turn to anger, and in the end, anger ends up getting us. And so on the show today, we wanted to ask an expert, give us some tools for how to go through this. Dr. John Livingstone is joining us. He's an associate professor here at Brigham Young University. This week is Education Week on BYU campus, and Dr. Livingstone is teaching a class on anger management. He also has a really interesting history. He's fluent in Navajo. I'll take that as a yes.
Yes.
But you also served a mission for the LDS Church as a mission president. So if you've ever seen those missionaries, the LDS guys out there, their white shirts, walking around in pairs, Dr. Livingstone was one of their leaders in Detroit City.
Yes.
So here you are in downtown Detroit, but you also have the psychology background, and you speak Navajo. Is that where you went on a mission?
I did. I served down in the Southwest. Of course, I was a Canadian boy, so coming all the way to Arizona, New Mexico, Southern Utah, Southern Colorado. Great experience.
Oh, I
wouldn't
bet.
Trade it for anything.
Well, it also gave you great experience kind of multiculturally. And, I mean, anger, it's everywhere. And it almost seems like it's getting worse.
It's not just Americans. It's not just Canadians.
Yeah.
It's everyone. Everyone has feelings. Everyone can choose to emote if that's what they decide to do. And again, there are negative emotions like anger. There are very positive emotions like love.
Yeah.
Attraction is more of a feeling, but love is a decision.
And it should – see, but that's it. We kind of – sometimes we sell that love is an emotion – a feeling.
Yeah.
But it's not. It's really a choice. You got to choose it and choose it and choose it.
It's a thoughtful choice, and you know, in lasting relationships, we choose love every day.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
It's not just something we find.
No. Oops. Oh, my goodness.
Oh, there it is.
I love you again. Look at that.
Because that's whenever somebody says, yeah, I've fallen out of love.
Yeah.
I guess they've moved to.
They really don't. We sing about falling out of love as if trip. Whoops. Oh, my goodness. I just fell.
I just had it. It was right here.
It's a very conscientious moving away and deliberate, sometimes sabotaging.
Yeah.
But yeah.
You were going to give us some tools to make sure that when we're in that moment, that spark where – you know, there's been a stimulus. All of a sudden, there's something we have to deal with, an emotion. Something has happened to us that's engaged us, in, I guess emotionally, but a feeling.
Sure.
What do we do in that moment?
Can I suggest that in those moments can happen at home, at work, you know, on the street,
right,
et cetera. And so having the presence of mind to realize that you're getting angry and to – like I was suggesting, maybe shout stop in your head. Some people will say count to 10, you know, whatever. But if you can just stop and reflect on what is the feeling that is causing me to choose to be angry. And, you know, again, am I shocked? Am I embarrassed? Am I hurt? Am I frustrated? Am I worried? Now, there's lots more feelings than that. Mm-hmm. Betrayal. We could go on and on. But sometimes just a few of them. And I'll invite people to actually memorize those. I'll say, see if you can memorize these in a few seconds. You know, shock.
Let's go over them again one more time.
Shock. Yeah. Embarrassment. Hurt. Frustration. Worry. Now, again, that's not a complete list,
sure,
but it covers a lot of ground.
You bet.
And if someone realizes that they are just steamed, torqued, angry, again, shouting stop or somehow just interrupting the automatic flow from feeling to emotion, then it's possible for them to kind of analyze, just a second, what happened here? You know what? She really hurt my feelings.
Right.
And then – what I suggest, and here comes the psychological tool, number one, some kind of expression of caring. Now, in the home, we can say, I love you. Now,
right.
That may not be appropriate at work. Oh, Shirley, I love you. You know, what? Oh, get away. But we can, you know, I love working here. You know, I love you as a boss. You know, there's some way of expressing some kind of caring consideration. Maybe it's appreciation or something like that. But then getting down to business, when you said what you said about my nose, that really hurt my feelings in front of all those people. Now, again, what we're trying to do here is to go back to the feeling.
Yeah.
I was embarrassed or I was hurt. But doing it in a context of caring. So my little tool is a sandwich here. It's kind of, I love you.
Yeah.
Off with his head. I love you.
Yeah.
And what we're trying to say here is that giving a context of caring couches the exchange of feelings in a better context than just going after the
right
feelings, because it makes sure that people know that you care and you're not just lashing out, and then finishing up with that context of caring.
Right.
Again, does the same thing so that you're not creating an enemy here, but you are getting down to business.
And we're getting it out. We're saying it. It's interesting when you say shock, embarrassment, hurt. We may trigger by only one of those, and that we might notice that there's a constant trigger in our life.
Yes.
That a lot of our anger is around one of those, right?
Yes. And we may become kind of like I said about frustration starts near your toes and works its way up. If we don't go after these feelings and we're constantly either stuffing them or glossing it over or whatever the case may be, it may tend to build until suddenly we are enraged and we go off on some poor person who has no idea that this has been going on for some time.
That's right.
But if we can kind of intervene early – but in a context of caring, why, what a difference that makes.
How powerful is that?
Getting down to business.
Well, you can also just see, you can see like in Ferguson, mm-hmm, Missouri.
Yes.
That when we don't, when people have real pain and it's not heard, they may be hurt, embarrassed, shocked, and oppressed even.
Yep.
And if it's not dealt with, then it'll turn into emotion and it will swell and it will blow.
Boil right over.
And it's almost like we can do this personally in our marriages, But it can also happen like it, civically. It can happen in your city. It can happen in your town. It can happen in your country.
Yes. In a way, what we're suggesting is that dealing soon and appropriately at the right level with mm-hmm. your feelings kind of avoids a victimization development. Because if this problem is with a boss
yeah.
or with a supervisor or with a, you know, a husband or a wife, letting it go causes this building of pressure that really results in something that can go over the top
sure.
like we've seen there. So that not only is sort of the offender have some responsibility that we want to
right.
deal with in a context of caring, but the individual who has been hurt,
yeah.
shocked, embarrassed, I'm suggesting can actually step in and do something
right.
about it
well,
rather
you saw
than
it.
Just suffering.
One of the great kind of standouts in the Ferguson situation is that Officer Johnson
yes.
who could come in and could show caring in a way that no one else could show caring. And what it seems like it does is it lowers the emotion, because a lot of what happens in situations like that is my emotion then creates contagion on yours, and this contagious emotional – and there's a great quote that says emotion hijacks meaning.
Yes. The mob reaction, the mob mentality mm-hmm. is – contagious.
And then everybody watching it that doesn't understand the context or the hit, like I think of white suburbia that doesn't understand what black inner city goes through.
Yes.
They're on the outside looking at like, why are you so angry? And that but it becomes this mess
yeah.
that we probably do. We just need more caring to understand the triggers, what's really going on deeper
yeah.
and find solutions.
If we can talk about how we came up with the feelings that showed up.
Yeah.
And if we can somehow, again, do that in a context of caring, and there are entire communities that have kind of done that sort of thing, but even on an individual mm-hmm. basis, oh my goodness, we can tone down the difficult rhetoric
yeah.
at home and, again, publicly, privately.
It also – another interesting dynamic I see is the – then we argue stories.
History.
And history instead of – what instead of a root emotion and a root – or actually, I guess a root feeling.
Yes.
The minute you're telling the stories and we're all hijacked emotionally, nobody cares and nobody's listening. We're just going to one-up your story.
And it gets crazy.
And then it's a crazy debate. Instead of with your wife or whatever, listen and help her figure out, so what was the trigger? And so if you felt shock or embarrassment, talk to me about how that happened and what does that feel like?
Yeah.
And go deeper into what they feel and then care enough – that people are hurting.
Yeah.
I mean, when you listen to the news about Ferguson or anything, it's more everyone's justifying and it's logical why you're hurt.
Yeah.
But nobody cares.
Yeah. As a university professor, sometimes I'll say to my students, the academy only has half a brain. It's the left half. And this caring and consideration and thoughtfulness and judgment mm-hmm. Is something that we all have, and we need to bring it to bear. Logic will not
right.
solve everything, particularly in intimate relationships
yeah.
in the family.
And yeah, particularly when the emotion's already flooding.
That's
right. Once emotion's flooding.
Yeah, it's gone. And anyone who's been raising teenagers knows
oh, yeah.
that it's like learning to drive a stick.
That's right.
You know, gas, clutch, freedom,
it's a nice
responsibility.
Balance. That's right.
You know, and how can dad or how can mom not go off on
right.
on a teenager whose brain really isn't fully
right.
developed yet.
Well, and you'll always have the right. You can always go off. It's just in the end, it's not going to solve it. It's not going to serve you.
No.
It'll just exacerbate.
Yeah.
Man.
What a deal.
Powerful. We're talking with Dr. John Livingston here, an associate professor at Brigham Young University. He's teaching us about anger management. When we come back, we're going to continue the discussion. More ideas, more tools. If you have a question for Dr. Livingston, give us a call. 1-855-CHAT-BYU, 1-855-CHAT-BYU, or text us your question to at BYU Radio. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back. More coming up on BYU Radio. Welcome back, friends. Today we're taking on anger management. We've seen it. I mean, honestly, today is probably a perfect example. You've probably seen some form of it in your home, your marriage, your extended family with in-laws. You may have seen it, you know, nationally as we're struggling and trying to understand what's going on in Ferguson and try to understand both sides of it the best we can. And also internationally, when you think of, you know, Al-Qaeda, you know, assassins, ISIS, cutting, beheading people. I mean, anger. It's killing us in many ways. And I guess, we're joined by Dr. John Livingston, BYU professor, associate professor here. And today, actually this week, he's teaching during Education Week here on campus a class on anger management. I mean, is it a pretty packed class? And I bet they're pretty rowdy. Are they a little angry?
I'll tease them. But tomorrow morning at 8:30, yeah, we'll talk about, you know, managing anger in the home. And of course, the home is a very intimate circumstance. It's not quite so public. People will say and do things in an intimate situation that they would not do otherwise. And of course, I suggest that people try to be the same person privately as they are publicly, so that they have almost a spiritual consistency in their integrity.
Yeah.
Same thing.
Yeah, then you don't have to try to hide it or figure out what am I supposed to be here.
Yeah, yeah. No sort of double life. And it's possible for us to look upstanding and good and solid publicly. And then in the home, we kind of come apart and we're after our spouse or we're after our children. And your real happiness really insists that you are the same privately as you are
publicly. I had a client. It's so great. We came up with this really great rule. I teach skills and communication, conflict resolution skills to get couples talking, and the guy just says, I don't want you to, because we were talking about timeouts, calling a timeout in this moment where they're starting to see the emotion. He says, I don't want you to say anything because the minute you start talking, it makes me mad. So we agreed that she wouldn't say anything, and. But so if your church leader was standing there, would you fight her? And she said, no way, because we went to our church leader and we're sitting in front of our bishop and he wouldn't fight with me there. He was very docile and nice. So I said, why don't we just agree that instead of saying anything, she'll just pull out her iPhone. Not when you're mad, but when it's starting to elevate. Why don't we just pull out our iPhone and just record it? So they made a rule as a couple that they would record any time their conversation started to get out of hand.
Yeah.
Guess what happened?
Changed everything.
Isn't that weird? So that's the higher brain, right? Now we're controlling it.
Yes. And we're just taking a moment to analyze just a second. Where am I at? What's happening here? Oh, that's what's happening. Okay. And then dealing with the real root issue.
That's right. And then get down. That's what you keep saying. Get down to the root.
Yes.
You're like the trigger emotion.
Yep.
And then – but that's a very – and some of those, by the way, didn't come from me.
Yeah.
That may have been something you learned as a kid is about how painful embarrassment is because your dad used to always embarrass you. So now it's a major trigger for you in your life.
Yeah. And whenever that occurs, oh my goodness, you just have this almost allergic reaction.
Yeah.
And of course, then the move to anger becomes even all the more automatic. But what we're saying here is that if we can use our whole head and not just logically figure things out, but in a context of caring so that we're not creating the kind of problem that we're trying to solve.
Yeah.
Emotion very often creates shock, embarrassment, hurt, frustration, worry.
That's right.
And just compounds the issue. And you tend to marry someone of about your equal personality strength.
Right.
And then you raise these little people who, of course, then develop equal strength. It's spectacular.
Yeah.
Nuclear.
Then it's game on. Yeah. It seems like, too, when you take the issue of our pattern and you don't make the pattern our problem and you don't let the pattern of our fighting be between us or even what you did to hurt me, as long as that's between us, it seems like we're just going to keep fighting our side.
Yeah.
I like to move it out and then bring the person close to me, which is I think what you're saying by show caring. So
yes.
We just have a weird pattern here, honey.
Yeah.
I call you this, and that ticks you off because it strikes that basic issue of being embarrassed. And so let's go look at that pattern and almost take it outside of you. I care about you. I don't want to trigger you that way. Yeah. Does that happen?
Of course it does. Learning to go after or to attack the problem instead of the person.
That's huge, huh?
Is critical. And I've done the same thing in my former private practice where asking people to almost sit close together and put the problem out front.
That's what I do. Put it on a piece of paper or on a whiteboard and stand and look at it outside of you.
Yes. If you're going head to head, and we go head to head not because we're so different, but because we're so equally strong, determined, equally right.
And we're emotionally hijacked.
Exactly.
So now you're going to go head to head.
And when you're dealing with just emotion, it's almost like little children who will cover their eyes and try to whack somebody or something else. When in fact, no. We want couples or individuals who are emoting in the workplace to be able to kind of step back, stop, not only think about it, but in a context of caring, go after the issue, go after the problem, doing it thoughtfully, but keeping it on that feeling level rather than rising to emoting, which is just sort of a bludgeoning psychologically.
And that seems like that's a trick. So when I see a coworker emoting, I guess I need to make sure I don't catch the emotion. I don't take that feeling and be offended. Yeah. I could use it as a source of, okay, this is telling me there's a deeper trigger issue. It's shock, it's embarrassment, it's hurt, frustration, worry. There's something else going on with him.
Yes.
So if I could get him to share that with me in a softer way.
Yeah. So
I could help him.
This process almost vaccinates you against over emotion. Mm-hmm. Now, I wish I could sit here and say, oh, I never emote.
Yeah, never.
I never get angry at my wife, you know.
Just when she gets out of hand.
Yeah. But the fact is, I'm still an idiot and I can still fall into those. But when we begin to realize there's a problem, again, if we can stop our normal automatic progression from feelings to emotions, why, it makes quite the difference.
Yeah.
It really can help us as we teach our children that sort of thing.
That's right.
You know, if someone were listening to this for the first time today, I would say to them, especially if I'd been sitting visiting with them, that if you can teach this to someone else that you know, it'll burn it into your circuits further and further.
Hand it down.
And greatly increase the likelihood that you'll actually use the tool and make a difference. Publicly, privately, all the way around.
Because you could see how this could almost become a tradition. This is a genetic thing. Your temperament, we might think, is handed down, but the lack of skills is also going to be handed down.
Oh,
what
yes.
a great thing to give your children, your grandchildren, is some conflict, some emotion management skills.
Yeah. And again, this context of caring always helps in the home.
Yeah.
Usually when children are grossly misbehaving, either we've got this anger problem that's been there, or sometimes you'll have an actual brain problem where someone has a personality disorder and borderline personality disorder where the main feature is anger. And when people actually have a brain disorder, it can be a little difficult to work with. But as long as you know that something is triggering that anger, even in those situations, you may be able to kind of logically explain what's happening to a personality disordered individual who can logically appreciate what you're saying and may be able to pick up on some things.
And what's fascinating about understanding that is if they're angry at me because their brain is broken.
Yeah.
Why am I reacting to it?
Yeah.
They're sick. They're hurting.
Right. And when we recognize that, and sometimes moms and dads will have a little brain disordered person, and it's not a matter of what we normally would call a mental handicap where IQ is low.
No.
It's almost as if that other side of the brain has a problem, and oftentimes it takes quite a while for us to figure out that we are dealing actually with a brain problem, not just a bad attitude.
Then we could have the same compassion we might have for someone that's mentally handicapped.
Exactly.
You can have for someone that's emotionally handicapped.
Yeah. I care.
I care.
Here's how this
Which is
affecting
Which is a basic
me.
Need. Every human wants to know that you just care. That's all they want to know.
Yeah.
We could probably solve Ferguson if everyone could just agree to care.
Yeah.
about what happened.
Yes.
And it was a tragedy, and both sides were tragic.
Yeah.
And we all should care, and it doesn't justify past abuse or real abuse or...
You got to face the music, huge. Face the real deal.
That's right.
Yeah. And if we're unafraid to do that, wow.
Change the world.
Yeah.
Change
the family.
That's right.
Change your marriage.
John Livingston, thank you so much.
Good to be here.
Keep up the good work.
Bless you. Good to be here.
By the way, 10 generations of John Livingstons in this world. That's pretty cool.
It's true.
That's really cool. We're going to take a break, folks. Continue our discussion after the break here on the Matt Townsend Show. When we come back, we're going to talk about anger at work. Somehow Sean O'Neill has some insight on that. I don't know where he gets it. It's obviously not in this studio. More fun, more ideas, more tools to help you deal with your emotion. Coming up next on the Matt Townsend Show. Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the Matt Townsend Show. I'm your host, Dr. Matt Townsend, your life coach, your guide on the side. Today, folks, I will be your anger management manager.
Okay.
Why did you say it that way? That just made me mad.
Anything makes you mad today.
I'm about to go off. Hey, today we're talking anger management. Who better to talk about anger at work? Sean O'Neill.
Yeah.
Why are you, you don't sense any emotion, negative emotion?
No,
nothing but
never.
Joy.
I've never been pulled into my production, my program manager's office and been told today's your last day, back it up and leave.
Yeah. That sounds horrible.
No, it doesn't happen.
That won't happen.
So no, I've never experienced anger at work.
Ooh, did they walk you out? Did they escort you?
Yeah.
We shouldn't be laughing.
Mm-hmm.
That's sad. So you're going to teach us about what to do to keep our cool while we're at work.
Yeah.
Because you can't go off. Like, sadly, no. Some
well,
do
Well, there
home.
Are some people who do go off
they
at
do.
Work, and that makes for very
Why are you looking
ugly
at James?
Situations. Well, because there was actually a situation the other day that Mike pulled a prank here at work.
Mike did?
There was
a
stapler and Jell-O involved. And so, but we had a recording going, and here's what we got.
Here's a little news flash. It's not funny. In fact, it's pretty freaking unfunny.
That was an overreaction.
Actually, that's from The Office.
That's from The Office. But that the same thing happened to James.
It was very, very yeah. Similar
were
response.
Were you the one who punched the wall?
That was me. Yeah.
Sounds horrible.
So.
Yeah, so you need to teach us. What do we do to not, A, don't put someone's stapler in Jell-O?
Right. That's one thing you don't do.
Yeah.
Don't punch the wall either.
Yeah. Don't put their cell phone up in the ceiling.
Mm-hmm.
Don't do any of that.
None of that at all.
We don't
but
do
if something,
anything
if
like
something
that.
Happens at work that
yeah.
makes you angry, first step, breathe. Do that, you know, that old count to 10 thing?
Yeah. But, you know, that doesn't work.
It can.
Because I can count to 10 while I'm rolling my sleeves up, ready to pound on someone. So you got to count backwards from 2 million.
There you go.
By 17.
Okay.
You'll never get mad.
But, it you know,
yeah.
that
but
little breathe
pause,
step, though,
breathe.
It may not. It's not
no,
going
it
to relieve
works.
What's the stressor might be that's making you angry.
Yeah, but it works.
But take a break, a pause right there.
Yeah, exactly.
Don't react immediately.
That's right.
In other words,
you need to create a space.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the space can be, and by breathing, you'll get more oxygen, which will relax you. It'll center you. Yeah, it's all good. It's all good.
Next thing you can do, actually,
turn your mic on.
I did hit the button.
You did. It's
yes, I did. It didn't turn on its own. I'm very angry.
James should
about
have
that.
Caught that, but.
That's okay.
He's so relaxed over there.
Yeah. Next thing you can do, though, is write it out.
Yeah.
But don't
Don't
send it out.
Because if you write it out, you're going to get all that emotion out.
Right, exactly.
And then you can look at it and say, well, that'll get me fired.
And you're probably better off actually grabbing a physical piece of paper and a pencil or a pen.
I totally
rather
agree.
Than typing it on your computer.
Yeah, do you know what I teach my clients to do? Write one line, and then you write your next line on top of the first line.
Oh, so you can't read it?
And you write the third line on top of the third line, the next line on top. So you go over it three times. You can't read it, but your emotion's gone.
Yeah.
And it's out of you. It's really cool.
The danger about doing it on the computer is you could possibly click reply all.
That's
exactly.
That's the big danger.
Right.
Yeah. Don't mess with that. Yeah. By the way, don't formulate your letter in an email program.
No, no, no. It needs to be a word processor.
Always
if anything.
Write it in a word processing program.
Not an email.
Then attach it.
Yeah.
Safer.
I wouldn't do it on a computer at all.
Yeah, let's just stick with writing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I would use a rock and a chisel.
There you go.
That'll get the energy.
Actually, that would get
Tell
the frustration,
wouldn't it?
You
would be exhausted by the end of that.
I don't know. I think that would increase the frustration with the whole process.
Not necessarily.
I have to chisel a letter.
Yeah.
Thank you, Fred. So number three on this list is vent to a trusted colleague.
Yeah. I like that.
If you have, you know, you have somebody at work that knows the ins and outs of your company and things like that, that you trust,
right?
That is a good friend of yours, maybe, that knows maybe what the situation was that made you angry, just go
vent.
Yeah.
Do you remember?
And tell them you want to vent.
That's right. Can I vent on you for a minute? Tom Rath was a guest of ours once, recently. He wrote a book called Vital Friends, and he talks about how having a friend at work that you can vent on helps.
Yeah.
Like it actually increases your productivity, your happiness at work by 50-60%.
I bet.
So that's why I think we've got each other.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we do that. We turn off the mics and then we just have a vent session.
Sometimes.
It seems like a lot of times when I walk in the room, everyone quits talking.
There's no reason for that.
Yeah,
there's nothing to worry about.
I wouldn't think about it too much.
I mean, it seems like every time. It's like I'll leave, go use the restroom, come back. You're talking because I can kind of hear your talking, and then I open the door and you guys get real quiet.
I'm sure it's just a coincidence.
It is. It really is.
That's good. Good. Good.
Yeah. One thing though about this venting, make sure you're not doing it in a cubicle.
Some of these seem self-explanatory.
That's the key word there. Yeah. Seem.
don't do it like in the break room.
Well, exactly. Don't do it in an open space. Go out to lunch with
get
your friend.
Get off of property.
Exactly.
Off of the site. Go out to the little vendor truck.
Mm-hmm.
Grab your bagel.
Where you won't be standing right next to your boss's office.
Yeah. Exactly. And don't do it underneath your boss's office with his window open.
Don't go sit on the bench underneath your boss's window. I think we've covered all potentiality.
Okay. Number four, get a little love.
Pardon?
Yeah. Get a little love.
Come again. What do you mean?
You got some good friends? If you can sneak in a quick text or a call to hear a familiar voice.
Okay.
If you don't have a friend at work that you can vent to.
Yeah, that's good.
If you can call your wife.
Yeah.
Call a friend.
Hon, I'm calling. I need you to walk me off the ledge.
Yeah, talk me off the ledge.
Talk me off the ledge. That's good. That's great advice, actually, isn't it?
And then if you have to, find your happy place.
Yes.
Whatever that happy place might be.
It's going to be Deer Hunter 2014.
I see.
That'll change your life.
Okay.
But see, anything. I mean, you maybe, like if you just got all, you know, wrapped up about a meeting, you maybe need to go on a walk.
You know what? If the arcade is just down the street and you've got a couple of quarters in your pocket or something.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yeah.
Or just fetal position in the corner.
That's my favorite. If that is your happy place.
It is my happy place.
Is that your happy? Because I've noticed you do that a lot. That's weird.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's really happy.
But you don't have to suck your thumb.
No.
What? Really? Yeah.
That's just James's
approach. It helps. I don't know.
Yeah. You know, it works for James. That's great advice. Anything else?
Maybe you can throw some Angry Birds out on the phone.
You know what I like to do?
What? Deer Hunter 2014?
No. I like to go look for other jobs.
Oh, really?
And then never really apply.
Well, that happens too. The last one on the list, though, is take a break. If you absolutely, you know, if you just get out of the building.
Yeah.
I mean, we've been saying that already, but
get out.
Just get out of there.
Remove yourself
from the situation.
Yeah.
From the place that's reminding you what's going on. Now, you have to come back and face stuff.
But also, you know, if your job is mission critical, like, I don't know, if you're a surgeon. Yeah.
If you're running a show on the air.
Yeah. Because, like, you know, right then I was about to just leave.
Yeah.
Or then I like, you know, I better
it's
go
like,
back.
It's like James as well.
James will get mad.
Being on the board.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not like he can just, you know, waltz out of here because you make him angry.
No. That's why I've got him.
By telling him,
like,
you know, that you're playing Deer Hunter 2014 all the time.
Jeez. That's making me mad. Mm. Now you're using my Deer Hunter.
Well, in other words, you know, everything on here, just let it go.
Let it go.
Just seeing if we can make you more angry.
It's working.
Good. All right.
That song's driving
Maybe we'll have you out of here by the end of the show.
Why does that song make me mad now? I used to love it. I don't know. Anyway, we're going to take a break, folks. That's all you needed to know about. I mean, again, none of you, nor do any of us, except for apparently four of you, have problems.
Oh, no. I have no problems whatsoever at work, ever.
I know.
None.
Can we just agree that when I come in the room, you all keep talking? It makes me feel uncomfortable. I just want you to know that.
Just because you hear crickets doesn't mean we're.
Well, I mean, you're laughing. It's all jovial, and then I walk in, and it's like reverent.
Mm-hmm.
Well, is it reverent?
It's because we have respect for you.
Yeah,
that's it.
Yeah, it's respect.
I thought it was that. Okay, problem solved. We're going to take a break. When we come back, Jenny Layton will be joining us from thehappygal.com. She is going to teach us about anger in our families and how to manage it at home. Again, I'm trying to give you the tools right here on the Matt Townsend Show on BYU Radio. Welcome back, all you angry birds, to the Matt Townsend Show. Today we're talking about anger management 101. We've had a lot of wonderful guests and discussions. How do you control your anger? And, you know, when we thought of the angriest contributor we could find, it wasn't Jenny. So she'll be happy to know that. Joining us by phone right now, Jen Layton. Jenny Layton is the creator of the blog The Happy Gal. She also released a cookbook recently, Healthy Eating the Happy Gal Way. She's a mom, she's a writer, a speaker, a blogger. She's done it all, a wife, and she still manages to remain happy. So today, Jenny is going to teach us how to handle anger at home with our children. Jenny, are you there?
Yes, I'm here, Matt.
You are so not an angry human. Have you ever been angry?
You know what? My son was we were just talking about this segment, and he said, you need to tell them all how you've learned to not be as angry.
Oh, wow. That's great.
So that's straight from the mouth of the witnesses, I suppose.
Yeah, yeah. I think they call them the victims.
Yeah. That sounds too harsh.
It does sound harsh.
Mom guilt. I don't want to have that.
No, you. I don't believe you have ever been mad in your life or angry because you're the happy gal.
Well,
are happy gals angry?
Well, we use techniques to diffuse it.
Yes. Everybody's angry. Everybody can have a bout of anger.
Yeah. That's just normal life, and I think that's one of the big breakthroughs that you go through when you get a little bit, I don't know, more self-aware, and that is that everyone's going to feel every emotion, and there's not a wrong one. It's just learning tools to kind of move through them and a little more gracefully. So.
And especially how powerful the role is as a parent teaching our children how to do this and doing it with our children.
Mm-hmm. It's funny, when you were talking earlier in the show about, you know, people that might be angry relatives or friends or coworkers, I thought, if there is one place in your life where anger really comes out, I hate to say it, but it's true that it's at the home, I think.
You bet.
It's because all our, you know, all our defenses go down. We're free to be who we really are. But there's this interesting little bit of research that also really explains why, with kids in particular, that anger management is really important. And so here's some I've got a big word to throw out here.
Oh, boy. Here we go. Here we go. Hold on. Let me get my pen.
Medical.
Yeah. Okay. What's the word?
Okay, so with kids, their frontal cortex of their brain is not completely developed.
I know.
That darn frontal cortex.
The PFC, I think the prefrontal cortex. It's not quite together.
So that's the part of their brain that helps them self-regulate. And so obviously when they're going through emotions and they don't know what to do with it, anger is a really easy pathway to get onto.
Yeah.
And so when you're at home dealing with a bunch of kids, then anger is going to come up. And so this is a great show today for people because everyone has children in their lives. If not their own, then, you know, they're around them to a certain extent. So.
Yeah. And before we get into some of the tools, talk about the impact of it, because it seems like moms already have a pretty major bout of, you know, guilt and, oh, I need to be better than I am. And so then we get mad. That's one of the things about anger for me is it always just leaves me feeling like a bigger jerk.
Mm-hmm.
And so then you got to go back and mend that. And it, so, I mean, I guess I'm assuming moms feel that too.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think that just brings me back to the whole focus of my business. And that is this message I'm always trying to get across to women. And that is that if you can focus on fixing things within yourself, it's automatically going to translate to your relationships and the way you treat people. So everything we're going to talk about today is how you can model behavior, but also how you can start to help your kids because their brains aren't developed enough to do it on their own.
Yeah.
You're going to help step them through a process that will help them be able to manage that their emotions and their anger better. And if you personally know how to do that, that's going to be a really natural, easy thing for you to do with your kids.
That's great.
So, it just comes back to it is so right and so good for you to take some time to focus on some of your stuff that you need to fix. It blesses everybody.
Well, and think about, you know, families and parents. If we put this on the radar and we are all dealing with it together, how mm-hmm. powerful is it as a family to hold each other accountable? I remember Stephen Covey, and I don't know if I've told you this or said it on the air, he used to talk about if any of his kids were throwing a fit or breaking down, they had a lot of family discussions about what should we do when one of us is just not being healthy, they're out of sorts. And mm-hmm. the whole family kind of decided together that when somebody's throwing a tantrum or angry, they would just act like monkeys around him.
I think I may have heard this.
So they'd start dancing and and they start making these monkey noises around him, like pick bugs out of his hair. And now, honestly, in my family, that would get you shivved, right? That would get you killed.
That's what I was thinking.
But in his family, I guess nobody carries a shiv. So, but interestingly, though, talking about it as a family meant we could respond to it together as a family. And what it did is it created an awareness that there's a space between when you want to go off and you're going off that you need to make a better choice, or we're all going to act like a monkey around you.
I choose monitoring myself before everyone turns into a monkey.
That's right.
How about you?
It's powerful. I think that's it's cool, but I think your goal as a parent is, you know, to teach them as, you know, as they're developing, but also to make it, this is our family problem. We're going to combat this.
Yeah, I think that's great. And, you know, I've seen that work in my family to a certain extent. This is one of the points I was going to bring up, and I think this leads into it really well. So I have a daughter who is a little on the anxious side, and through some counseling, we had a counselor bring up the red light, yellow light, green light concept.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with that?
Yeah, but explain it.
So green light is everything's groovy. Yellow light, you're starting to kind of get out of sorts, and you can feel your defenses or, you know, anxiety or anger, whatever it is, starting to come on. And red light is when you're out of control. And really, by the time you hit that red light point, it's really, really hard to pull yourself back out of it. Then that's when the mom guilt comes out because you've not acted well with your family, or, you know, the kids will maybe get even more angry because they're feeling guilty also about the way they've acted.
Yeah.
And so the key is to be aware of that process. And so when you feel yourself shifting into that yellow light, to give yourself the space that you need. And really, as a family, we've been able to incorporate that concept pretty well, where my husband will even say, are you in a yellow light to me?
Yeah.
sometimes that isn't the best thing for me to hear, but it does help everybody know, okay, we need a little bit of space right now.
That's
even
great.
With the happy gal needs a little space right now.
Yeah, you're like, no, but I'm about to be.
I'm going orange really fast.
Here I go. But see, that's just making it, giving a tool, right? Having something that, and a language we can use. I love that.
Yeah, and it's amazing. Even little kids can pick up on that. My five-year-old can use that. And so I think that's a really great visual concept that you can give even to younger children. But the whole family, like you were saying, the whole family can step in and understand when they see people hitting those different phases and know to give support or to give space or whatever.
Right. Does when you think about how you use that, do you see your other kids that don't have anxiety picking up on it as well? Or is that just kind of the adults and the one that learned it through counseling?
No, I think it's really good for everybody. It's interesting because I'm in the teenage world now, as my oldest is almost 15. And so I can feel when our interactions together are starting to go into that yellow light.
Yeah.
And that's a signal to me, even though, you know, my pride is coming up and I'm wanting to respond a certain way, to bite my tongue. And, you know, because together we're going to a yellow light.
Yeah.
And so, you know, it seems to be a really great concept across the board, whether you're using it for anger or anxiety or whatever.
I love it. See, when I think of a yellow light, I think, hit it, go as fast as you can, which is kind of probably counterintuitive, but it really means slow down, be cautious, clear the space, prepare.
Time's awareness.
Yeah, I
mean,
love it.
Awareness, yeah.
That's great. That's great advice. So, and then your daughter gets it, and because to me too, you could have your daughter be able to tell one of the boys that are bugging her or whatever, "Hello, I'm starting to go yellow here.
Yeah,
get off my back."
And the trick is for that other child to respect that.
That's great.
And to care enough. So, you know, you just keep working on that part of it as well. But it's great to give them the language, because a lot of times they just don't know how to express it.
That's right.
So that's been good for our family.
And then maybe when you go back in and you see them again, if they seem happier, you can say, "You seem like you're back to green."
Yeah. Yeah.
And we can show that, you know, there's a full circle here. That's cool.
Mm-hmm. And that's really smart, too, because you're giving positive reinforcement to that process.
Exactly.
And so you want to make sure you don't miss out on that opportunity.
Oh, man. Man. Okay, Jen, hang on with us. We're going to take a break, but we're going to come back, and I want you to keep teaching us.
Okay.
More skills to you know, mitigate some of the anger, the negative emotion in the family. Being taught to us by the Happy Gal. You got to go to her website, thehappygal.com. Jenny Layton's her name. Emotion and Anger Management. That's her game. I think she's green light right now. And by the way, she's probably at a green light because she doesn't dare ever call from home when she's on the Matt Townsend Show, because her kids are out of control. We're taking a break, folks. More when we come back with Jenny Layton from the Happy Gal right here on BYU Radio. Welcome back, friends, to the Matt Townsend Show. Having so much fun. A lot of levity in our breaks. We laugh. We're raising it up. Hey, on the phone, parked in some remote location, hiding from her children, windows up, air conditioning blowing in her face, Jenny Layton is on the phone. She's the creator of the blog The Happy Gal, author of the newly released cookbook, Healthy Eating, The Happy Gal Way. And she's teaching us the Zen of Happy Galdom. Is that right, Jen?
I like that. Yeah.
You're teaching us how to keep our cool.
What?
You're trying to teach us how to keep our cool.
Yeah.
And then how to teach our kids the, you know, anger management skills, basically.
Mm-hmm.
One of your tools so far, red light, green light, yellow light.
Yeah.
Green light means floor it, go right ahead. Mm-hmm. Yellow light means proceed with caution emotionally. We're starting to go yellow. You know, I'm starting to feel like I'm a yellow light. Can I just get some space? Red light means what?
Watch out.
Watch out. Mama's mad.
Or kids are mad.
Or the kids are mad.
Whoever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think we're going to start using that around the studio here.
think that's good.
Don't you think?
We all have the same language.
Yeah. That's what we're trying to do. Get everyone on the same page. What are some more skills you got for us, Jen?
Well, I think maybe the most important one that I want to focus on is one that I think is just counterintuitive almost to parenting, and that's why I think it's really good to talk about. And really, I think human nature in general, because when your child is in, you know, having a tantrum or talking back or misbehaving or something, you just kind of want to say, go to timeout, go down to your room, just get out of here,
right.
Go cool off.
Right.
That's pretty instinctive, I think. But really, research kind of tells you, don't do that to your kids, because, so the guest, John Livingstone,
yeah.
the 10th,
yeah.
right here. That's
yeah.
pretty impressive, by the way, that 10-generation thing.
Oh, that's right, yeah.
Anyway, you know, you guys were talking a little bit about how the anger is really kind of a byproduct of some really scary negative emotion that people have experienced,
mm-hmm.
right?
Right.
And so here the child has gone through whatever triggered that emotion, and they're scared of these feelings, and anger was how they responded, so now they're scared of how they behaved. The last thing they need to have happen is be left alone with all of those feelings that they don't understand.
That's
and
true.
Don't know how to control.
That's such
and
a great
so,
point. Plus,
yeah.
we're teaching them to run away from it, which
yeah.
I see coaching couples later. Everyone's good at kind of running away.
Mm-hmm.
But it's almost you need to learn to stay in the emotion, and just everyone just kind of needs to calm down.
And isn't that interesting that as parents, we've got the power to teach that lesson to kids while they're so impressionable?
Yeah.
And yet, if we ourselves don't understand how important that is, then we're not going to know how to teach that to our kids. Again, just why that's so important for us to understand, really, you know, healthy mind and behavior. And
right.
But I think that's a really interesting point when it comes to helping kids. Contrary to that whole time out, what if you did a time in? You know,
yeah.
where, Kate, so you're driving me crazy, and the last thing I want to do is be with you right now, but I understand that what's going on here is scary to you, and so let me set my feelings aside, and let's sit down together, and if it's a small child that'll let you hold them, let's talk it through. If it's an older child, you know, try to stay in the same space and maybe get a dialogue going so that you can talk through what's going on, because they're not going to understand it. They're probably not even going to have the words, especially the little ones, not going to have the words to describe,
no.
well, I was feeling really frustrated, you know?
I was perplexed, Dad. Yeah, they're not going to have that, are they? But what's cool is, and this is the number one thing I find working with the couples I work with, it's they need the emotional management skills to stay in the space, because if you're always avoiding these threats, these problems, and you don't know how to stay in the space, you'll never fix a relationship never being in the space. So just mm-hmm. staying there long enough, letting the emotion be there, but find a safe way to say, okay, yellow light or whatever, let's be quiet, or let's talk about it. Let's just stay in the space till our emotion calms down. Eventually our brain will rewire itself, and we
yeah.
won't see this as a threat
yeah,
or conflict as a threat.
Yeah, well, that's what I was going to say. I think that's a really cool part of it, is when you're there with your child in that moment, you are actually helping them connect those synapses in the brain and lay that, you know, blaze that trail through their brain that this is how we deal with problems. And as they feel confident, more confident, and they feel safer with some of those emotions, they're
yep.
going to be able to figure out how to do that process on their themselves. So they'll need you less and less, which is exactly what we're trying to do as parents, is teach them to be independent. So, you know, just the wherewithal to know how to do that with your child at a young age, or, you know, if, even as a teenager, that's a great time to introduce it if you haven't done it before. It's just going to help them so much as adults, and then you see in your practice how it affects relationships. Think what would happen if you were raising a whole house full of really emotionally intelligent and resilient people who were heading into the marriage relationship, what that would do.
Think of how many marriage coaches I could have.
Mm-hmm.
I could open
yeah.
a business and just have all my children coaching. I could make millions.
I think an idea was just born.
Oh, man. You just see, that's the business coach in you. I really, though, I think it's way cool. I think it's a great gift we can give them. And it's not always, you know, sometimes, too, it's we don't know any other patterns, right? We don't know other ways of doing this. So it's kind of like and this is, I guess, what you do as a coach a lot too, is it's just letting other people know there's other rules, there's limits we can give, there's more constructive ways that we could do this.
Yeah. And you know what? Let's talk about that for a sec. I think that's a really good point. I think helping them know limits in terms of it's okay to be angry. Every emotion is fine. It's okay to feel that mad, and it's okay to feel that hurt or that resentful. Those are all normal emotions. The thing we don't want to do is help them feel like, or cause them to feel that those emotions are not okay, because they'll suppress those. And we know that's a
right.
bad idea.
Yeah.
You know, eventually we're relinquishing control on those emotions once we suppress them, because those, then it shifts into subconscious control, and that's not a good thing. We want it, then it's work to bring
yeah.
it back into the conscious realm. And so I think just helping the kids understand that all of these emotions are okay to feel, and it's a normal part of life to feel all of them. And here are the limits. When you're angry like that, here's what's okay and what's not okay. You know, it's not okay to hit somebody. It is okay to get really mad, but let's not hit. Let's
right.
find another way to let out some of that aggression if that's what we need to do.
That's great. It's not okay to call names. It's not okay to you know, throw things.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah, or to talk disrespectfully to your parents.
Yeah.
You know, that's another good one.
It is okay to make us dinner. It is okay to vacuum.
Clean the bathroom. Go for it.
Whenever you get angry, we'd appreciate it if you just go clean. Use your energy to clean.
Let's see, do something productive with all that adrenaline.
That's a great coping skill.
Well, we're coming up with a lot of good ideas. You've got a family of marriage counselors in my bathroom.
Yeah.
They're going to be sparkling.
Oh, yeah.
Let's keep going.
I do something with cookies. It is okay to make cookies.
Yeah. Healthy ones.
It's funny because these moments of emotion can be a lot of times just they become such a big moment, right? It's this pivotal moment in anger, and we've never seen. I mean, I remember once I ran away from my house. I was gone easily. I was easily gone 4 hours.
Wow, how old were you?
I was 24.
I knew it.
No,
I knew something like that was going to come out.
Yeah, that. No, I was probably 8.
Wow.
But I was so
great.
Hungry, I had to go home. And but then going home, I remember, was always hard too, because you know, how do you do that gracefully? Okay, mm-hmm. I'm back.
I'm back.
But don't let it happen again, or I'll leave again. But next time, I'll take chips.
Yeah, yeah, it's rough, you know. And like we said, it's the home where all of these emotions were kind of let down our public face, and these kind of things happen. But again, it's why the home is the greatest place to learn, because everyone is so just themselves.
Yeah.
You know?
And it's safe. So, I mean, that's, I guess, too, the key to this is, and part of it, I know emotionally, is the recovery. They're saying the ability for you to recover from emotion. So if you can stop it, stop the reaction, not get flooded and taken over. And then stay together, and then show some love and recover.
Mm-hmm.
It's the recovery they're finding out is one of the best signs of how well you'll do in your marriage, is your ability to recover from your problems.
Yeah, I like that, actually, because I know personally, for me, when I have gotten to the red light,
yeah.
When I haven't managed it well enough, I notice that the red light can be a lot shorter if I can instantly tell myself, it's okay, because people do this sometimes. Sometimes you lose your patience. But when you're too hard on yourself, I think that you're fueling the red light time to just go longer. You're fueling your anger
right.
to just perpetuate. And I've noticed that as I've watched other people and also myself, that guilt will still fuel anger, you know, because you start feeling bad that you did it, and then you even want to run away even more, so you keep choosing anger.
Yep.
So I think recovery is really important, and I think it's really important to recognize that once you have been angry, that's a normal thing too, but let's just move on.
I guess we could take the advice of President Obama and Hillary
okay.
Clinton. They just got in a little spat a few days ago, where they decided they're just going
to
hug it out. And then they
I
never let the press see
it.
They never showed the video of them hugging it out, but apparently maybe that's part of the recovery. We just hug it out. I mean, on this show, that's what we do.
Good.
Whenever we get in an argument as a team, we always hug it out.
I'm going to just purposely instigate a little fight next time I come down to see that in
yeah.
process.
Yeah, do that. Yeah, you start a fight and see how that goes.
the happy gal's going to pick a fight.
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, Maddie's still trying to grow some hair back from where Alyssa pulled her hair out.
Alyssa's new.
She's brand new.
Yeah. I just got an email from her. Well,
she's awesome.
Good. Maddie needed another woman down there.
That's right. Now Maddie's not alone. Yeah. She's never been alone, but now she's really not alone.
She's
back.
Got another girl on her team.
That's right. Well, Jenny, you're the best.
Hey, thanks for having me. It's always fun.
It was way fun. And everybody, go check out thehappygal.com and look at her blogs. She's got tons of information there, as well as a cookbook that makes sure you eat healthy. The Happy Gal way. Jenny Layton's her name. Thehappygal.com is her website. Thanks for joining us. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we're going to wrap this show up. I think we've eliminated all the anger. Now we are not angry birds. We're happy birds. And we're going to come back. We're going to hear some roommate stories. Roommate stories gone bad. It's like Cops from campus. This is the Matt Townsend Show. You're listening to us right here on Sirius XM 143 BYU Radio. Welcome back, friends. We're wrapping up the show. There's the hoedown music.
I always want to scat to this part. Something like that. Is that okay?
Is that scat?
Is that scatting? That's scatting.
I always thought scat was something else.
Come on, show me. Then Matt, you prove me wrong.
Isn't deer scat something else?
Anyway, that's what that is.
But, you know, they're very similar. No, I can see.
You're making fun of me. I'm not going to get angry, though. I'm calm.
I'm not sure that was scatting.
That was Scooby-Doo.
Because there is a singing term known as scatting, but that doesn't...
Sean's trying to say is that that wasn't singing.
All right. Man, I was 1 second. I almost broke in and started scatting.
Right.
I really did.
Your scatting would be much, much different, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. Did you hear how deep that was?
Yeah, that was really good.
Thank you.
Wow.
Hey,
Rachel.
we're gonna wrap up the show.
Bat cave back there.
But before we do, we wanted to talk about, and I don't know why it went to roommate stories.
They're fun because you get angry at your roommates.
Yeah, I was gonna say,
I haven't had a roommate.
Some of the most
for 25 years.
Yes, you have. You've had a permanent roommate for how long now?
I call her my mate, not my roommate.
Well, she's still a roommate.
She's my life.
You
mate.
Pay rent together, don't you?
Actually, we own our house.
Well, that too.
I do pay rent, though.
But so you've got stories about where you wanted to crush.
This is the best part, yes.
Okay.
Well, I have James here.
James was a roommate.
Yeah, we were roommates. We can share these together because we had pretty good roommates. I've had much worse.
Is this going to be personal? Because I don't...
There might be some punches thrown, but I have this screen between both of us.
That's right. So. I'll mediate. I'm here to mediate.
The screen gets thrown.
Just let it go.
Oh, yeah. No, please no.
Oh. 1, 2, 3, 4.
10 seconds.
This is why I'm in the other room now.
9, 10.
I know.
Okay.
You okay, Matt?
I'm good now.
All right.
So how on earth could a roommate not be anything but heaven?
Well, exactly. Actually, to that point, sometimes you don't really know when you first start out a semester. You move in, it's like, how do I know if my roommates are going to be weird or if they're going to be like, we're going to be friends? And it's always that awkward moment. I feel like it's a month or maybe 3 weeks to where you don't really talk too much. Mm-hmm. And when we first moved in, me and James, we knew each other, but I had all my belongings like in the room, you know, and he had all his, we were sharing a room and it was all there. I had a TV that was in, we actually set up in that room instead of bringing it out in the living room.
Yeah.
You didn't want to share.
By the way, I've seen it. It was a big screen TV.
Yeah.
And you didn't want to share that with all the other peeps in the apartment.
I wanted to make sure that I wanted them to take care of my stuff. And you don't ever know if you're living with slobs or who.
Yeah.
So we actually got there early before they came in there. We had the TV in there. We decided to move one of the couches.
Yeah, of the two couches that were in our living room,
we took one and put it in our room. We're like, we're just going to have our own little party in here until we know these guys.
So they were actually ended up being pretty cool. The TV
went
out.
You guys sound like horrible roommates.
I know. We were pretty bad roommates. We like would close our door sometimes at night and just do our own thing. Yeah,
it reminds
me
of an episode of Dumb and Dumber.
What? What?
Not that you are that way. But, okay, sure. But they don't get the impact they have on everyone else.
Yeah, maybe that's accurate.
Okay, keep going.
Well, we became friends, but then even though we were friends with it was Greg and Logan, our other roommates. We did run into some problems, and James has a story about one of his dishes he lent to all of us that got kind of destroyed.
Okay.
Yeah. So. Like, I bought this brand new nonstick pan. It was beautiful. It was red.
It's supposed to be nonstick.
It was nonstick. Oh, it worked perfectly, yeah. Flawlessly. But, you know, something that you run into with roommates is that some people don't respect your stuff as you would. So,
sure.
My goodness, the guy, one of our roommates would use, he wouldn't use, the plastic spatulas and stuff on it. He would use like forks and everything. And when he'd clean it, he would scrape it.
Yeah.
Therefore, within a month, my pan was destroyed. And
did you shiv him?
Yeah, I tried. He always blocked it, and so
you
turn around. And you're like,
shiv
cut.
Is
like,
the word of the day on the mat.
Hey man, what are you doing? Yeah. Like, nothing. Stranger. Just
so he ruined your nonstick pan.
Yeah, yeah, just like that.
You had to put like a stick of butter to make it not stick.
And even that didn't work.
Yeah, it was pretty bad.
Yeah.
Then it's awful. Not a nonstick.
Yeah, it was a stick pan. It was like glue.
It's just a regular
pan.
Yeah. The bachelor pan.
Except when you scrape that coating off, it's Teflon. So then you're like poisoning yourself.
Yeah, exactly. That's another thing I didn't think about. Yeah.
Yeah.
Blame Thanks it a lot,
on
so, Greg.
When you guys have some cancer in 50 years, blame it on him. Okay. Yeah. Good job, Greg.
And so this actually is another part of the story too. So we're trying to, you know, wash our dishes the right way, and we're out of dish detergent. What do you call it? The dishwashing soap. Because you have like detergent for the laundry, but then it's the dishwashing soap. We ran out of that. We decided to use the dish soap you use to hand wash the dishes.
Yeah, liquid dish soap,
and it made so many bubbles it like half flooded our kitchen one time.
Wrong decision.
And our roommates walk in. We actually, you know what? We made it a good experience, but it made me realize, man, if one of them was uptight,
let me guess, you actually cleaned the floor that night. Yeah, our floor was spotless.
That day we decided to clean the floor, and the people downstairs got really angry.
Yeah, they weren't
too
happy.
I have no idea why. Their ceiling was very clean. So.
But you know, the one thing, though, that you could learn from all of this is your kids are going to be doing the exact same thing.
Oh, yeah. The whole time I'm sitting there thinking,
that's my child.
Those are my children.
Exactly.
Yeah. Well, and the thing that I find interesting about this, that Jenny was talking about how the anger kind of comes from somewhere. She mentioned guilt. And I find that a lot of these situations, it's communication. You know, the fact that we haven't talked about it, you know, how to properly, you know, treat my stuff or whatever. And so it's just this lack of communication that's causing all this anger that really isn't necessary. If we just talked about stuff, then like there wouldn't be any reason for this frustration and anger.
Maybe they were just being passive aggressive because you took all of the furniture out of the living room.
Probably.
We had to take the legs of the couch off to fit it through the door. It was it was epic.
We took the door off its hinges.
We took the door off the hinges. Yeah. Yeah. It was stuck.
The couch was not meant to go in the bedroom.
We made it get fit.
But it was
communication. That's
great. We took it back.
Yeah, fortunately, we reached the point in our relationship where we put the TV up there and returned the couch.
We actually had interventions that now you mentioned. We talked. We got close enough to where we did talk, and that was cool.
Like, okay,
so,
guys, okay, we'll move the TV out.
Well, yeah, not just that, but like other things about what's appropriate maybe to watch, things that bugged each other, and that was cool. I haven't had that with my other roommates. There's some other stories that
I won't
mention.
But have you done that with your wife?
Wait till you guys married.
I think that's going to take...
Oh, wow.
I don't know. I'm still... it's only been a couple months.
Have you given her have you taken her to YouTube and showed her the Teflon Don video of how to handle your nonstick pans?
No, not yet, Matt. I'll have to do that. Can you put that
on
your Facebook page?
I would before James comes over.
Oh, yeah.
It's going to get ugly.
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Because it's weird. Now you've moved from the dating... Yeah. Or not the dating, the roommating to now you're married.
Oh, temporary roommate to permanent roommate. It's, you know, and it's different, but a lot of the habits and things, skills I learned from that experience and also serving an LDS mission, being with someone else, you learn all these things that you want and what you don't want to do and habits. So.
See, it's the process of life. This is the cycle of life.
Yeah. Lion King.
Cycle/circle.
Sorry, yeah. We don't have that song.
We don't have that one.
I was waiting for the
Which
drop.
I would have loved, but I was like hoping, man,
I just
do
want
we have
someone
that
to
song?
Sing. I scatted.
Circle of life. Okay, I'll never do that again.
There's a shotgun in the studio.
Pajamas.
See, that's where I'd want Deer Hunter 2014. And just start shooting you guys. Not shooting, because we don't use guns
of course
on the radio.
Not. Yeah. No, they're not allowed in the building. Sorry. No.
Yeah. So that's all you got.
Yeah.
That's a good lesson.
I mean, yeah.
Have you learned? All of you
have
learned?
I learned?
Have you learned?
I don't know. That you have to ask my wife. I feel like.
Well, she called me yesterday, and apparently you haven't.
Yeah.
It's because you're coming in for a session next week.
You put the TV. You didn't put the TV in the living room.
Yeah.
Put it in the other room. Just for yourself. Well,
he wanted it in the bathroom.
Have it on my side of the bed in the bathroom.
But it was
yeah.
a fire hazard.
Well, I figured we could just shower in the kitchen. But
here's a final quote for all of us from Dr. Lawrence J. Peter. Speak when you are angry, and you'll make the best speech you'll ever regret. Can we just all agree to just let's just not
don't punch
stay
the
angry.
Wall.
Everybody, keep cool. Keep yeah. cool. That's the advice. Tomorrow, hey, best of the Matt Townsend show tomorrow. We won't be on the air, so it's a best of show. The show will be on the air. We won't be here. Thanks for joining us again. We'll be back Monday. More tools, more ideas to help you find the good in life. You're listening to the Matt Townsend show right here on Sirius XM 143 BYU Radio.